Hi everyone, I'm Ben, and this is the Board Game Blueprint. It's the season of giving, so I thought we'd go over the mechanic trick-taking instead, just to see what all that is about. So let's jump on over to the table next door and see what we have in store. Now, trick-taking is a bit of an abstract concept, at least it was to me at first, and luckily for us, the first game that we'll go over today, Parakeet, has some handy-dandy rules about basic trick-taking as a mechanic, which is really great. The general idea is that players will have a hand of cards to choose from, and they will be playing in sequence, each player playing a single card to try and win the trick, essentially a round of play in which every player will drop down a card and try to play it to the trump suit, that is to say a certain flavor, or in this case fruit, that they want to win as the trick. Hopefully that's making sense so far, because the idea is that the highest number played of a given fruit, that is the trump suit, in the case of Parakeet, will be the winner. And you, in the game, are trying to collect these blue diamonds for victory points. Parakeet does things a little bit differently, in that it also has you calling how many points you think you can win in that entire round of play. So not a single trick, but by the time everyone has gone through their entire hand of cards, seeing how many they can win. Another rule that most trick takers have is that you must follow the trump suit if you have a card of that suit to play. That is to say, if orange was the trump, then everyone from their hands would have to play an orange card if they could. If they didn't, then they can throw out whatever they want. And strategically, playing this cherry that had victory points was maybe a less ideal play for that player, because the player with the highest, again, in the trump suit, will claim that trick, that round of cards, and add it into their scoring pile, in this case here. So turns will just continue to go until all hands are extinguished. And sometimes in trick-taking games, the lead player will decide the trump suit. That will range depending on what the rules of the game are, and Parakeet actually has a number of different trick-taking games to play to add a little bit more variety into all of that good stuff here. So as Kiwis, the three was highest, so they would claim all of these cards and score one victory point for their team. As you may have seen, each game is going to be different with what gems score, and so that's another thing to maybe look forward to in Parakeet, with a lot of extra replayability. Most of trick-taking lies in being able to read your opponents and figure out maybe when they're holding on to something higher, or when would be a safe time to play something a little bit lower instead. So once more, if 8 was the leading trump, then they would win the trick, or take the trick, but if the trump was still orange, then the orange player, or the player who played the orange card, would actually win these points here. A lot to look forward to, and I want to say that trick-taking is normally a very kind of short mechanic, where a lot of times you can play until you decide to stop playing. But in other games, like Pot Divine, we'll see a slight twist. Oh, and for Parakeet, we actually have score cubes as well. One of them to keep track of the actual score, and then one of them is to keep track of your bid. When I was mentioning earlier how many tricks you think that you can win, will also factor into how many points you actually score for that round. Whew! In Pot Divine, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, players will, just like in other trick playing or trick taking fashion, have a hand of cards in which they will try to play a card that matches the trump suit. So in this case here, to win, they might play the 4. Now, the extra twist with Pot Divine is that every player will have a number of bribe gems that they can spend to pass their turn, essentially, and not give up any of their cards. The cool thing about this game is that when you play, whoever wins the trick is actually going to collect these different classes of cards, and there's going to be a set collection aspect to the game as well. Normally, in trick-taking, you want to be the person to win the most tricks, but Pot Divine kind of flips it on its head a little bit by having a range of different types of cards. For each, you'll score a different point value. And so you might want to make sure that you have more or less than the median, or else suffer a negative penalty. The other crazy thing too is that in this game there are kind of four negative cards, pot divin, which I think is just potion of wine or something like that. But as you see here, it's a shoot the moon sort of idea where if you can collect all four of the negative cards, you will actually score a huge positive bonus to your score. So again, you have to be thinking even more about which tricks you're trying to win or take, as opposed to other trick-taking games where it's kind of a more direct approach. I mentioned previously that some trick-taking games can play on arbitrarily. There might be not a fixed game length until people just sort of get tired of playing tricks, but in Pot Divin, there is a trump deck that is determined by the number of players, essentially dictating how many rounds of play there will be until a decided winner is resolved. Trick-taking is one of the more difficult concepts, game concepts, for me to have grasped, and I think the reason why is because it's just so not visual. But a friend of mine, Caleb, for his game Horn of Plenty, turned trick-taking into a more visual design. The idea here is, just like with any other, that each player has a hand of cards, and they must follow a previous trump card. So in the example here, might play a 16 of pumpkin, and then the next player would have to sort of combine that or follow that path. Now we have a visual representation of what trick-taking looks like, and that I'm really thankful for. So an entire trick might look something like this. And we have here that 16 is the highest, so the player who started that round would win this trick and receive a number of points. Now, this being the Holiday of Thanksgiving inspired game, there is something called generosity tokens, and that's going to be these green cubes here. For every path that you open up for someone else to play on, like how these lanes go across and open up other options, you'll receive a generosity token that you can cash in at the end of the rounds for extra points. Just like here, how you open up less spaces, but you open up another color that someone can connect to would also, I believe, garner you a generosity token as well. And so this extra visual element, for me, really clicked what trick-taking was all about. And I love seeing neat little twists like this that help breathe new life into already tried and true mechanics. Not to say once you've played one, you've played them all, but trick-taking is pretty universal, and it's always cool to see what people are combining with it, whether it be that set collection that we saw in Pot Divin, or special scorings, like in Parakeet, or maybe just a really accessible version of the game, like we have here with Horn of Plenty. Oh, last special note too, the cards go all the way up to 18 for each trump suit, but if they're ever placed with a 1 of the matching trump, then the 1 will actually take the win. Being able to tell when to hold your cards for the next trick, or play them in the hopes that you'll win it all, is a huge part of the draw, and hopefully you'll be taking lots of tricks to come. I hope you enjoyed this little dive into what trick-taking is, and hopefully I was able to convey what makes it such a very compelling mechanic in games. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button so that you can stay up to date on future content like this. As always, I'm Ben. This has been another episode of the Board Game Blueprint, and together, let's build something great. Happy holidays!